What are the risk factors of aortic dissection? Now we come to an MCQ point. Without asking anything, if you see a question in that exam, what is the most common cause of aortic dissection? Or what is the most important or most common risk factor of aortic dissection? Your answer should be hypertension. Hypertension is the most important and the most common risk factor of aortic dissection. And other risk factors include connective tissue disorders, which can weaken the vessel wall, especially affecting the collagen fibers. Now, if you see a patient between the age of or 40 to 60 year old men with long-standing hypertension, so greater than 90% of the cases of aortic dissection are these individuals. So vast majority of the cases, if you see a patient who come to the emergency department with 40 to 60 year of age, you can say that hypertension is the cause. Now the question comes here is, why hypertension is responsible for the weakening of the vessel wall? Why long-standing hypertension, why essential or primary hypertension is responsible for the weakening of the vessel wall? So here is the story. In long-standing cases of primary or essential hypertension, there will be a hypertrophy of media of the vasa vasorum. What is vasa vasorum over here? Vasa vasorum is the blood vessel that supplies the blood vessel, which means we know that we have three layers in the vessel wall, that is intima, adventitia, media. Adventitia as well as media, both are supplied by vasa vasorum, but intima, especially the endothelial layer, receives its oxygen by the process of diffusion directly from the lumen. So endothelium is not receiving its blood from the vasa vasorum, but the entire vessel wall, including the adventitia as well as media, especially depends upon vasa vasorum, right? So in long-standing cases of hypertension, more commonly in systemic hypertension, which is also called as essential hypertension, there will be hypertrophy of vasa vasorum. So if there is a hypertrophy, what happens? There will be a diminished blood flow to the aortic wall. If there is a diminished blood flow to the aortic wall, we know from the cell injury chapter that whenever there is a decrease in the blood supply, the size of the cell will be compromised. There will be a decrease in the size of the cell, or sometimes there will be a cellular loss in the tissue. So here also there will be loss of smooth muscle cells in the aortic media. So whenever there will be a shortening of the smooth muscle cells, loss of smooth muscle cells in the aortic media due to the hypertrophy of the vasa vasorum in the conditions like systemic hypertension weakens the vessel wall. So this is the pathogenesis which is present behind the hypertension. So that is the reason hypertension is considered to be the most common cause in individuals who are at the age of 40 to 60 years who present with aortic dissection. Now, if you see a patient of aortic dissection, but they are younger, means younger individual less than the age of 40. I'm not talking about any gender over here. So younger patients with aortic dissection means hypertension is not considered to be the most common cause. So connective tissue disorders are considered to be the most common cause in younger patients affecting the collagen and elastic tissue present in the wall of the aorta. For example, Marfan syndrome is considered to be the most common cause of aortic dissection in younger individuals, but in general, Marfan syndrome is considered to be the second most common cause of aortic dissection, right? So Marfan syndrome is considered to be the second most common cause of aortic dissection in general, but if I talk about younger individual below the age of 40, Marfan syndrome is considered to be the most common cause, but not the hypertension. This is how you have to know about the most common cause of aortic dissection in the older as well as in the younger individuals. So here we need to note an important point, that an important disease which is causing cystic medial necrosis is the Marfan syndrome. So in the exam, if they ask you, what is the disease which can cause cystic medial necrosis? your answer should be Marfan syndrome. That is considered to be the most common cause. So what is Marfan syndrome here? The Marfan syndrome is an autosomal dominant disorder which causes a production of weak elastic tissue. Why there is a weakening of the elastic tissue? Why there is a production of the weak elastic tissue? Because of the defect of the fibrillin synthesis, mainly due to missense mutation. So autosomal dominant, missense mutation, defective fibrillin synthesis, responsible for the development of weakening of the vessel wall. So in such conditions of Marfan syndrome, there will be a dilation of the ascending aorta, may progress to aortic dissection, and we can say aortic valve regurgitation also. And what is a mitral valve prolapse? Mitral valve prolapse we can also see in this Marfan syndrome. We are not discussing in detail about the mitral valve prolapse over here, but remember that mitral valve prolapse is considered to be the most common valvular defect, and it is often associated with the conduction defects and causing sudden cardiac death in Marfan syndrome individuals. In the same Marfan syndrome individuals, because of the defective in the fibrillin synthesis and there will be a defective in the elastic tissue synthesis, there will be a skeletal defects including hypermobile joints, and also we can see unucoid proportions where the lower body length is greater than the upper body length, and also arm span is greater than the height, as you can see in this picture. And majority of the individuals, where we can also see arachnodactyly, often called as the spider hands. In the same Marfan syndrome individuals, same due to the defect in the elastic fiber synthesis, there will be a dislocation of lens. Is an another important finding, because the suspensorial ligaments which are holding the lens are compromised, and because mainly composed of elastic tissue. So this is about the Marfan syndrome. And other connective tissue disorders which is responsible for the development of aortic dissection will be Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, due to the involvement of the type 4 collagen, or we can see in vitamin C deficiency, and also in defects of the copper metabolism. So in all these individuals also we can find aortic dissections, but in rare conditions. So two important points you need to remember about the causes. Like, you know, most common cause is hypertension, and second most common cause is Marfan. But in younger individuals, the most common cause is Marfan, right? But overall, if they ask you, the most common cause is hypertension. Now, if we talk about other rare causes, the third trimester of pregnancy can also cause aortic dissection, but it is very rare. Reason is, there will be an increase in the plasma volume, what you actually see in the third trimester of pregnancy, that eventually increases the blood volume. Increase in the blood volume causes increase in the systolic hypertension. The systolic BP, which is elevated, which can cause the vessel wall damage by creating a tear in the intima, may predispose to the development of aortic dissection, right? And inflammatory aortitis, example like Takayasu arteritis, we can also see the involvement of the ascending aorta may eventually predispose to the development of aortic dissection. So all these are considered to be the important causes of aortic dissection. In general, we should know an important point over here, that aortic dissection is usually not related to atherosclerosis. It is not related to atherosclerosis. But in fact, if you see, the medial scarring and fibrosis, what you are seeing because of the atherosclerosis, actually has a protective phenomena against the formation or against the spread of aortic dissection, right? So scarring and fibrosis in the areas of the significant atherosclerosis actually inhibit the propagation of the aortic dissection, because the scarring as well as fibrosis will not allow the further tear which has been created between the intima as well as media. So there's a reason you should remember that atherosclerosis is not considered to be the major important factor for the pathogenesis of this aortic dissection, rather than it has a protective phenomena. But whenever we talk about most common, always we also have to think about the rare as well as rarest cases. In approximately 10 to 30% of individuals, or we can say in a very small subset of patients with the aortic dissection, so-called penetrating atherosclerotic ulcers. So these penetrating atherosclerotic ulcers may cause aortic dissection, because such atherosclerosis related aortic dissection actually represent the minority of the cases of aortic dissection, because they differ significantly in the pathophysiology from the usual classic aortic dissection. Even though we will see in a very small subset of patients the aortic dissection which is associated with the ulcerated atherosclerotic plaques, but you should remember that it has more a protective phenomena rather than a destructing aortic dissection, or rather than complicating the aortic dissection. Right now, let us talk about the signs and symptoms of aortic dissection. So if the signs and symptoms of aortic dissection actually mimic the myocardial infarction, because the MI also presents with diaphoresis, that sudden onset of severe chest pain, and even aortic dissection also has like diaphoresis plus sudden onset of severe chest pain. But in aortic dissection, serum levels of cardiac enzymes will not be elevated. So if you see the values of CKMB and troponin I are absolutely normal in aortic dissection, but these are elevated in acute myocardial infarction. Now, when we come towards the diaphoresis plus sudden onset of chest pain, so there will be often a severe tearing kind of a chest pain in aortic dissection. This severe tearing kind of a chest pain often radiates to back. But if you remember the pain in myocardial infarction, it often radiates to the left shoulder as well as jaw. But in aortic dissection, there will be a shearing acute chest pain presents with diaphoresis, but it often radiates to back, that is between the two medial borders of the scapulae, and migrates inferiorly as the dissection progresses soon after the onset of the pain. So whenever we see the shearing kind of a chest pain plus diaphoresis, and the pain is radiating to back between the medial borders of the scapulae, and the pain is progressively extending downwards after the acute onset of the symptoms, is nothing but called as aortic dissection, and it is not the acute myocardial infarction. So this is about the signs and symptoms of aortic dissection. Complications of aortic dissection. So complications means the most important life-threatening complication will be a rupture. Because we know that the aortic dissection actually creates a false aortic aneurysm. This aneurysm may rupture through the adventitia, responsible for the development of hematoma, hemorrhage, massive hemorrhage. So depending upon the capacity of the blood which is flowing through the ruptured adventitia, the hemorrhage size can be determined, and based on the hemorrhage size and the compressing structures, we can say that the severity of the aortic dissection from less severe to the life-threatening condition. But remember that most often ruptured aortic dissection are catastrophic and leads to sudden cardiac death. So here the rupture sites, if we see in aortic dissection, as we already discussed earlier in the pathogenesis or pathophysiology, it includes the pericardial sac. Remember that the rupture into the pericardial sac is the most common site of the aortic dissection, and it leads to cardiac tamponade. So in the exam, if you see what is the most important complication of aortic dissection, then your answer should be cardiac tamponade, because the rupture is more commonly near to the pericardium, where the pericardium is attached to the greater vessels. So rupture in that particular anatomical area where the blood enters into the vessel wall, from there the rupture of the adventitia, where there is a direct entry into the pericardial sac and leads to pericardial tamponade. And other sites include the distal aortic dissection, which usually the dissection may be at the thoracic cavity, in the thoracic aorta, that is in the mediastinum. More commonly, the posterior mediastinum hemorrhage often represents the thoracic aorta rupture, right? So the blood actually tracking back into the lumen by rupturing through the inner media and intima to produce a double barrel channel in the aorta, but it is considered to be the rare complication. More commonly, the rupture may be in the pericardium, leads to pericardial tamponade, maybe at the thoracic aorta, leads to massive hemorrhage in the mediastinum, more commonly the posterior mediastinum, and maybe the formation of the double barrel lumen in the aorta, right? So all these are considered to be the important as well as the life-threatening complications of aortic dissection. Now, if you see the chest x-ray over here, chest x-ray in vast majority of the cases, or let me say in 60 to 90% of the cases, the chest x-ray will be abnormal with a widening of the mediastinum as the main feature. So remember that even though the widening of the mediastinum is not considered to be the diagnostic for identifying the aortic dissection, but remember, widening of the mediastinum in the chest x-ray is the most important x-ray feature what you will see in vast majority of the cases of aortic dissection, right? Now, and along with this, one should identify unequal pulses in the upper extremities, or sometimes observed, especially when there is an involvement or occlusion of the left subclavian artery or the brachiocephalic trunk, there will be asymmetry of the pulses between the both the limbs of the upper arm. So this is considered to be an important feature. Now, let's come back to the diagnostic studies. Actually, the diagnostic studies should follow rechecking the bilateral blood pressures and the radial pulses for symmetry, because the maintaining symmetry is important. If there is an asymmetry, then we can identify that the patient is still suffering from this aortic dissection. So one should always check the symmetry of the pulses, whether it is symmetry or asymmetry. By mainly ruling out the acute coronary syndromes, it is extremely vital for given similarities in the presentation with aortic dissection, because once the patient comes to the emergency department with the aortic dissection with an acute chest pain and diaphoresis, majority of the interns often say that, okay, it is the classical feature of acute myocardial infarction. There's a reason checking the symptomatology as well as the diagnostic studies and checking the BP and symmetry of the pulses in the upper limbs is most important to identify, as well as differentiating between the aortic dissection as well as acute coronary events, right? Next diagnostic modality is the CT, that is CT with contrast is the quick as well as non-invasive way to detect aortic dissection. So what is the initial diagnosis of choice and what is the quick way to diagnose aortic dissection means you should always go with the CT. But if we talk about the sensitivity as well as specificities, we have other diagnostic modalities which has more specific and sensitive when compared to that of CT. But if you see the CT, it has approximately 80% sensitivity for proximal tears as well as greater than 90% for distal tears. And next one is the TEE is the another diagnostic modality which has greater than 95% sensitivity for proximal tears and 80% for distal tears. It is exactly opposite to that of the CT and can also be utilized to detect other cardiac abnormalities like the pericardial diseases. But when compared to that of TEE as well as CT, in the exam if they ask what is the most sensitive test and what is the most specific test for aortic dissection, then your answer should be MRI, because MRI has greater than 98% of sensitivity as well as specificity, but it is time consuming, not quick method when compared to that of CT and not widely available. That is the reason most common means we go for CT, and most specific and most sensitive means we go with the answer called as MRI. So these are the three important diagnostic modalities which are more commonly available for aortic dissection: CT with contrast, TEE, as well as magnetic resonance imaging, right? So after the diagnosis, let us talk about the management. The management of the aortic dissections actually depends upon the location of the tear as well as the clinical stability of the patient. These two are important for management point of view. Now, in the exam, they'll ask you what is the first step of management? What is the initial step of management? The initial step of management is to stabilize blood pressure. you need to maintain symmetry of the pulses. So that is the initial goal of a physician, right? In an unstable patient, especially targeting heart rate as well as the systolic blood pressure. So maintain stability first. So then what is the medical treatment we will give over here? First, we will give IV beta blocker. Labetalol is considered to be the drug of choice, especially in such conditions. But first with IV beta blocker, that is labetalol, to blunt reflux increase in the heart rate that is often seen with the vasodilator therapy. And the most common vasodilator which is often used with labetalol, that is IV vasodilator, that is nitroprusside. So remember that nitroprusside plus labetalol IV is considered to be the treatment of choice in the medical management if they talk about aortic dissection. If they talk about medical management, then only you have to select this answer, right? Now, what is the agent which will use to control the pain, right? Because the pain is radiating to back between two medial borders of the scapulae and it is excruciating, tearing pain. And the pain can be managed by using the morphine, right? So morphine is used for the management of the pain as well as to maintain the stability as well as concentrating on systolic blood pressure and the heart rate. We are using IV labetalol plus IV nitroprusside, right? That is IV beta blocker plus IV vasodilator. Now, as we already know that according to the classification, Stanford A, which means the proximal dissections which require emergent surgery because they are more catastrophic when compared to that of the distal. So emergent surgery is often indicated for Stanford A type of aortic dissection individuals, and distal dissections actually can be treated medically unless rupture or occlusion of the branching artery develops. But more often we will see this rupture at the proximal area of the aorta, which is called a Stanford A classification, which always requires an emergent surgery, right? So this is about the treatment of aortic dissection, and by this we completed the topic called as aortic dissection.